See that Honda badge? It's a testament to endurance and Honda ingenuity. Rise to the challenge with the rugged performance of the redesigned Honda Ridgeline.
This is Stegman Coliseum, Athens, Georgia. I'm now for SEC Network Women's Basketball as tonight the Auburn Tigers seek their first conference win of the season against the number 24, Georgia Lady Bulldogs. Good evening, I'm Matt Stewart, joined by Coach Christy Thomas-Cuddy. And Christy, big game for Georgia. They're battling for a top four seed in the SEC tournament.
And more importantly, a top four seed in the NCAA tournament with selection Monday, just over a month away. Right now, Charlie Cream has UGA as a top four seed.
Lady Dogs beat Auburn 76-44 6 weeks ago. Tigers star Unique Thompson did not play in that game. She will play tonight. And Honesty Scott Grayson has been much better since that game, and she's coming off a career-high 30 against Missouri on Sunday.
Well, the Baylor transfer is hitting her stride. She can score at all three levels. She leads the Tigers from the three-point line. She leads them in assists and steals. But most importantly for them, she can finish off the bounce in the half court, but off of those Tiger turnovers where she can get out in transition and score. Matt, the crazy thing for her is 6 points in that first meeting with UGA. Since then, she is averaging 19 points a game.
She's been spectacular. Georgia hasn't played since last Thursday's 83-76 overtime win at Bama. Q Morrison, SEC co-player of the week based on her performance that night. 25 points, 5 steals, both career highs.
Well, the senior is Q on the spot right now. She is healthy. She is scoring at all three levels. Against Bama, she had it. Put it all together on both ends of the floor. She's been doing this consistently for UGA this season, leading them in assists and steals. But the difficulty degree on the shot that really sealed the win at Alabama. Q Morrison's on a roll right now.
And it was just the second career player of the week honors for Q Morrison. As you see Georgia in their pink uniforms tonight, the Play for K breast cancer awareness game for the Georgia Lady Bulldogs tonight. So they're decked. Coming in at 14-4, 6-4 in the SEC, three-way tie for fourth with Kentucky and LSU. Auburn, 5-13, 0-10 in the conference. But we anticipate a much different game here tonight, Christy, than they had back on January 3rd.
Absolutely. When you have Unique Thompson on the court, you have a chance every night. The most amazing rebounder that I can remember in SEC history as of late. And she can own the paint defensively. So I expect UGA to challenge her early and often here tonight.
And Georgia turns it over on their first possession. Here's a look at the Auburn starters. Going with Patton, Lowry, Scott Grayson, Levy, and Thompson. Tonight, Lowry, a last-minute change in that starting lineup. And Auburn scores first as Unique Thompson puts it in off the glass.
And Matt, we've talked about it. So important for Auburn to get off to a good start. They've dug a heel in almost every SEC game. They've battled back, but just a little bit too little, too late for them this season.
Yeah, they've been outscored 57-23 in the first quarters of their last two games against South Carolina and Missouri. And Georgia turns it for a second time. Quick break down the floor. Unique Thompson beat Georgia's defense. She's got the first 4 points of the game. And here's a look at the Lady Bulldogs starting five, the same starting five they've used in all 19 games this season. Conley, Caldwell, Morrison, Isaacs, and Stady. And Georgia sloppy to start this game.
Well, some of that is what you alluded to. They've been off a week, but also Auburn has come to play tonight, already so active defensively, and their offensive execution has been as good as I have seen all season.
Honesty, Grayson Scott in the paint and shot it wild off the backboard. On the break, Georgia trying to score in transition. Conley launches a three, and the rebound controlled by Patton.
And I think for both of these teams that tend to struggle in the half court offensively, they've got to get out in transition and create easy scoring opportunities.
So Auburn commits their first turnover of the ball game. 52nd all-time meeting between these two longtime rivals. Georgia's won 6 of the last 7, leading the all-time series 32-19. 19-5 here in Athens. Stady, first bucket for Georgia. That's a three-pointer.
Well, and that's what makes Jenna Stady such a tough matchup, because she definitely can score down low, that reverse pivot to create space, but she can also knock it down from deep. So Auburn's going to have to come out and try to defend her from the outside.
That's just the third three-pointer for Stady this season. Scott Grayson misses. Thompson gets the first of what will likely be many rebounds, and Stady gets the block. Stady, the number one blocker in Georgia, or in the SEC, total and blocks per game, three per game.
And you're seeing at Auburn, whether it's a make or miss so far, a 1-1-3 half-court defense. They're trying to be active, trying to force contested threes from UGA.
Stady beats Thompson to the low block.
Well, so far, you're seeing both coaches move their bigs around and hit them off the move to get them high percentage looks at the rim.
So Jenna Stady 5 and Unique Thompson 4 to start the game. Kia Patton had it knocked away from behind by Maya Caldwell, and last touch by Auburn. Kia Patton, incredulous with the call. She's one of the young ladies that Coach Terry Williams-Flournoy is looking to step up. She says, I love my 1-2 punch of Unique Thompson and Honesty Scott Grayson, but we can't have players playing 25 minutes and scoring 4 points. We need a third player to step up.
And this is where Auburn has to be able to score off of UGA's turnovers. This is what's the missing piece for this offense right now.
And Honesty Scott Grayson gets her first basket of the ballgame. Q Morrison fumbled it away. Georgia retains possession. Conley launches the three and hits it. Georgia leads by two.
Well, Q Morrison won't get any credit for that play, but she just sliced and diced that press, stayed with it when she fumbled it to get it kicked out to Gabby for the three.
Auburn turns it over. Bounce pass ahead for Q Morrison. She tried to bounce it back for Isaacs, and it was kicked by Auburn. Coach Williams-Flournoy, in her ninth season, you see the season summary for the Tigers, and an extraordinarily young team for Coach Flo, and you couple that with COVID-19 and the pauses, the delays, that's not a good combination.
And she's very honest about it. She said, you know, in a given year, we'd be so much further ahead defensively as much as offensively, and there was no way that we would be winless in the SEC. But she knows it's been an uphill battle all season long. But the good news, if you're an Auburn fan, is this defense is coming along. And as we've seen in the last couple of games where they played close, this team has not given up, and they are getting better each and every game.
Mallory Bates in the ballgame for Georgia. And a substitution coming in here for Auburn. It's going to be Kubali. Aisha Kulabali checks into the ballgame. And Conley off back iron. Georgia gets the rebound. It was Caldwell. Conley, Georgia's top three-point shooter, averaging just under 2 threes per game, 10th in the conference. Georgia turns it. And Auburn turns it with help from Georgia's defense. Caldwell, and a foul's going to be called on Unique Thompson. And Georgia at 14-4, as we mentioned, 6-4 under head coach Joni Taylor in her sixth season. Currently projected as a number 4 seed, but a lot riding on this ball game, as you alluded to, Christy. Charlie Crane says if Georgia were to lose this game to Auburn, they'd fall into a 5 seed or worse.
Well, anyone that follows Charlie Crane knows that he has put out each week a 64 seed tournament, a 32 seed tournament, and a 16 seed tournament, because again, nothing is for sure. NCAA has said we're gonna have 64 teams, but that's the bottom line, is you don't wanna be left out looking in. And so, very big game for UGA here tonight.
And the tournament will be held in a bubble in San Antonio this year, much like the men's tournament being bubbled in the Indianapolis area. The women's tournament will be bubbled in San Antonio.
Well, not just San Antonio. They'll use University of Texas facility, right, as well as University of Texas San Antonio and St. Mary's, with the Sweet 16 all being held in the Alamo Dome.
Right, and Austin, of course, right down the road, about 45 minutes outside of San Antonio. The banker by Conley.
Well, I like to say everything's bigger in Texas, so why not have a bigger bubble than the men have in Indianapolis anyway?
certainly will be an interesting experience as they have all the teams there and playing all four regions there. Thompson, shot contested by Bates. She stuck with it and put it in off the glass.
And that's where Unique Thompson is so good. She doesn't watch shots. She follows the ball as it comes off the rim. That's why she is leading the country in offensive rebounds.
Bates with her first basket. Georgia up by six.
And that's the key. Auburn lacks post depth. UGA obviously has a lot of post depth. How many different posts will Joni Taylor and her staff throw at Unique Thompson here this evening?
Wild shot. Foul's going to be called on Georgia. And that'll put Scott Grayson at the line when we get back. And when we get back, we honor Black History Month as we take a look at the SEC's hidden figures at Auburn and Georgia.
My body is truly powerful.
I have the power to lower my A1C.
Because my body can still make its own insulin.
Acidity activates my body to release it.
Lowering my blood sugar from the first dose. Once weekly Trulicity responds when my body needs it 24/7. Trulicity is for type 2 diabetes. It's not insulin.
It isn't for people with type 1 diabetes. Don't take Trulicity if you're allergic to it. You or your family have medullary thyroid cancer or have multiple endocrine neoplasia syndrome type 2. Stop Trulicity and call your doctor right away if you have an allergic reaction, a lump or swelling in your neck, severe stomach pain, changes in vision, or diabetic retinopathy. Serious side effects may include pancreatitis. Taking Trulicity with sulfonylurea or insulin raises low blood sugar risk. Side effects include indigestion, fatigue, belly pain, decreased appetite, nausea, diarrhea, and vomiting, which can lead to dehydration and may worsen kidney problems.
I have it within me to lower my A1C.
Ask your doctor about Trulicity.
Number four, Georgia leading Auburn 14-8 with just 2 minutes to play here in the first quarter. As we honor Black History Month here in February, let's take a look at the SEC's hidden figures from the Auburn Tigers and the Georgia Lady Bulldogs.
Well, Wendell Merritt being the first Black female athlete at Auburn and was a scorer through and through. And then when you switch over to UGA, you talk about Cynthia Collins, the first player in UGA history to average a double-double. And then the incomparable Bernadette Maddox, the first scholarship that head coach Andy Landers offered when he got the head coach here at UGA. Bernadette went on to become the first All-American as well as academic All-American for the Lady Bulldogs.
And Collins and Maddox, part of Andy Landers' first ever team. Joni Taylor was an assistant coach to Andy Landers, and so was Coach Flo. So a lot of commonalities here. And Lakeisha Frett, who is now on the Auburn staff with Coach Flo. Lakeisha Frett Meredith, as she's now known, was also a star here at the University of Georgia.
And coached for Andy Landers as well. So basically, all roads lead back to Andy Landers.
It was interesting. We talked to Coach Flo about that and asked her, you know, her favorite memory along with Keisha in her days at Georgia. And it was one of the special times. Georgia had Final Four teams back then. She says, I just remember we had to work hard for Andy. He didn't accept any excuses. He said, don't bring me problems, bring me solutions.
Well, and you're seeing a similar style from a defensive perspective that Andy Landers expected his teams to play with. And I can't say enough. I mean, when we talk about just the history and the significance of the SEC, it goes to great coaches. Pat Summitt, obviously, Andy Landers, Joe Champy, Rick Moody. I mean, we can go on and on and on as far as just the rich history of the SEC.
Scott Grayson at the foul line. McDonald's All-American out of New Jersey. Started her career, as you alluded to, Christy, at Baylor. Sat out last year following the transfer.
You know, I had the opportunity to watch Auburn practice a couple of times last year at Auburn. So was able to watch, honestly, Scott Grayson practice. And you just knew it was just a matter of when she could get on the court. She was going to make her impact felt. But there's still a transitional period, and we saw that in her early games, but she has been on a tear the last 10 games.
She can beat you in so many different ways, and Coach Flo says when she's hitting the three-point shot, that's icing on the cake. whistle away from the ball. Unique Thompson may have lost a contact. And Unique Thompson, one of the great stories in college basketball this year, one of those great stories that probably doesn't get as much credit as it deserves because Auburn's having such a disappointing season.
Well, a year ago, she had a lot of young guards, and I said it over and over, they needed to get her the ball more. This year, another set of new guards. And so Unique has just gone about just a workmanlike mentality, cleans up the glass, leads the nation in double-double, in career double-doubles with 54. And Matt, that's in the SEC where we know the post play is so good. And the scouting report, everybody knows Unique is going to hit the glass. It doesn't matter. She is so good at reading the trajectory of the ball, and she's just tenacious on the glass.
13 and a half rebounds per game, close to six offensive rebounds per game. Perspective, three offensive rebounds per game is considered really good. She's getting double that number. And she started the night 27 rebounds away from the all-time Auburn rebounding record.
And let's talk about the Auburn rich history. You're talking about players like Mayola Bolton, Vicky Orr, some Olympians. And this is where Unique Thompson sits. In my mind, as long as she doesn't get hurt, she's definitely going to break that record.
27 boards behind Becky Jackson, who set the record in the 80s. 5-point lead for Georgia as we go under 3 minutes to play here in the first quarter. Koulibaly missed the layup.
And those are the shots, if you're Auburn, you've got to make the layups, the points at, the shots at the rim. If you're trying to get over the hump, you got to make the gimmies.
But all in all, this has been a good first quarter for Auburn in that they haven't fallen way behind. That has been their problem throughout the course of the season, in particular the last two games. They've been outscored in the first quarter in 8 of their 10 SEC games and 4 times by double digits.
Absolutely. And to this point, they've turned UGA over 7 times, but I'll keep saying this, they've only been able to convert that into 5 points.
Koulibaly got it to Levy, had her shot blocked, and then they turn it over. Caldwell does not have numbers, takes it to the hoop anyway. Rebound by Q Morrison, battles underneath, and the whistle is going to be called a foul on Auburn.
Great effort by Q Morrison to run with Maya Caldwell. So many players just assume a make, and they hang at half court. Morrison continues on, gets that rebound, draws the foul.
What a game for Q Morrison last Thursday night at Auburn. The 25 points, which we mentioned, was a career high. The 5 steals, career high. Also had 8 rebounds. She scored 19 of her points, Christy, in the second half, 8 of them coming in overtime.
Well, I think when you talk about these two teams, that second half is a microcosm because what you have is veteran leadership from UGA. Maya Caldwell, 13 points in the game, all coming in the second half. Q Morrison, as you just alluded to, just took over in that second half from an offensive perspective. And that's what you have in the SEC if you're going to win consistently. You need veteran leadership because you need that consistency. And that's what Joni Taylor's had this year because of so many veteran players.
Well, it's been gratifying, no doubt, for the Lady Bulldogs program to see Q Morrison healthy. You take a look at her numbers. These numbers are where you thought she would be maybe in her sophomore or junior season, but because of injuries in those years, after a really good freshman year, she was all SEC freshman and then really took a step back offensively because she wasn't totally healthy in her sophomore and junior years.
Well, college athletics is hard, and any player that tells you they're completely healthy is probably lying to you. These players play through so many injuries, nothing severe, but nagging injuries, and there's a mental toll on that as well. And for Q Morrison, since that freshman year, just one injury after another. And Joni Taylor told us, you know, last year as she was coming back, she would rest on offense. She got in better condition down the stretch, and we've just seen her continue into this season.
And one opportunity here for Javin Nicholson as she is fouled by Scott Grayson.
The depth of UGA in the post. There it starts because of dribble penetration by Michaela Coombs, who forces a rotation, finds her weak side buddy, Javin Nichols, for the shot and draws the foul.
Georgia, the top free throw shooting team in the conference at 76%. Coach, that tells me a mature team, a team that is getting in there, getting in the reps, because that's what free throw shooting is all about, muscle memory. Just getting in there and repping it and repping it and repping it until you excel at it.
Well, Matt, if you want to be a championship caliber team, there's two shots you have to make consistently, layups and free throws. And you and I have done these games long enough together that when these guys were freshmen, we would just hit our heads at the missed free throws, the opportunities that UGA gave away because they couldn't convert at the free throw line. This year, you see the maturity. You, as you mentioned, you see the production based on the repetition.
So Auburn now in a 3.5 minute scoring drought. They've missed 7 of their last 8 shots and 5 in a row.
And this is where I'd love Unique Thompson to get a touch. Either go on ball screen with her or get her off the move.
3-pointer by Scott Grayson off the mark. Nicholson the rebound. Georgia can play for the final shot. Conley walks it across the half court line. Now under 10. Smith, Conley, they swing it around. Coombs with 2. Caldwell at the horn. And that's the end of the first half. First quarter, pardon me. Georgia 18-9 lead on Auburn after 10 minutes here at Stegman Coliseum.
On current. So what are you waiting for? Captain Ahab to help you find a parking spot?
There she blows. Whoop. Loading zone, darkness. To the north. The lots where there be spaces as big as whales.
Geico.
Start of the second quarter in Athens. Number 24, Georgia leading Auburn 18-9. Unique Thompson, 6 of the Tigers' 9 points. 4 of their 7 rebounds. Georgia started slow, Christy. 8 turnovers in that first quarter, but eventually righted the ship and shot 43%.
Well, as soon as UGA started taking care of the ball, the offense started flowing. But Matt, you said it, just sloppy early, sometimes forcing passes that weren't there. Once they calmed down and started getting looks in the half court, the offense opened up. Jenna Stady with 3, Gabby Connolly with 3. UGA just has to take care of the ball and they'll get wide open looks. But as you said, way too many turnovers in that first quarter to make Joni Taylor happy.
And Unique Thompson back out on the floor after leaving at the end of the first quarter, had a little bit of a contact issue. Only 2 players scored for Auburn in that first quarter, Christy. Thompson and Scott Grayson, going back to what Coach Flo told us. Love my 1-2 punch. We need more players to step up.
Well, you can't win in the SEC with just 2 players who score consistently. And Auburn came out in a 1-3-1 there out of the break. And UGA just made them pay with the 3.
Conley gives Georgia their 3rd 3-pointer. And Georgia opens up a double-digit lead. Foul's going to be called on Smith.
Well, the one thing, if you're going to run any kind of zone defense, you got to have ball pressure. There, UGA just sends it around the perimeter and finds Morrison in the corner for 3.
Q shooting 33% on our 3-pointers this season. And going back to what you were talking about a few moments ago, Christy, Coach Flo says you have to have at least 3 go-to players to win in the SEC. And some teams have 2, like us. Some teams have 5, like South Carolina.
Well, I remember UGA playing at Georgia Tech early in the season. And down the stretch, Gabby Connolly was on the bench. And it wasn't that she was doing anything wrong, but other players were playing well. And that's the luxury that Joni Taylor has this year. She has depth, she has versatility, and she's able to use that game in and game out depending on how she needs to match up. And that's the difference in a top 4 seed in the SEC right now and a team that's trying to get their first win.
Conley had to take that long 3 with the shot clock winding down. And you mentioned that Georgia Tech game. Freshman Sarah Ashley Barker hit a big shot in that game. She's not available tonight. Fortunately, our thoughts and prayers with her family and the family of Caitlin Host. Both of those players lost their grandmother last week as Javon Nicholson gets the basket, but to complete the Barker story, she stayed longer in Alabama, did not return to campus until just the other day. So because of quarantine rules and protocol rules, she's unavailable tonight.
And Matt, you said it perfectly. I mean, sometimes you forget that these athletes are young women and individuals, and so family first has always been the mantra with Joni Taylor and her staff. And so I'm sure if you're a UGA fan, you're happy to see Sarah Ashley back on the bench, Caitlin as well. But it's been a really weird year for everyone, and luckily for all these young student athletes, basketball has given them some sense of normalcy.
Yeah. When Georgia played in Tuscaloosa last Thursday night, Barker and Hose stayed behind in Alabama to attend the funerals for their respective grandmothers. And again, our condolences to their family.
So, Matt, one thing I've noticed from UGA already, they have played five different players in what I call a post position. So far with Auburn, only Unique Thompson. And the UGA posts are going at Unique Thompson, seeing if she will challenge them on the shots. And if she doesn't, they know they've got good looks.
And it looks like Auburn will be without Jayla Jordan for a fourth consecutive game. Knee issue. She was not involved in warm-ups as far as we could see. And, of course, she has not taken the floor here tonight. And so it's not a surprise, but they're down in their big position as Jayla Jordan's out again.
Well, Auburn runs zone defenses, and what's happening right now is the pace of UGA is not allowing everyone to get solid on defense, and so UGA is just feasting on the glass as Smith gets the offensive rebound put back.
So Isha Smith with the basket, and now the three-point opportunity. Georgia has out-rebounded Auburn to this point, 19-9. 15-point lead for Georgia. Remember, they won by 32 back on January 3rd.
And UGA's got a big lead right now, but it was just a very different feel to that game. UGA was tempo and transition, getting high percentage looks before they even needed really a half-court offense. Here tonight, Auburn's made them have to work a little bit more to get those looks in the half-court offense.
So Thompson at the line. Foul was called on Gabby Conley, reaching in. Thompson now has 9 of their 12 points. Number 6 in the SEC, scoring 17 points per game. Number 1 in the SEC, 13.5 rebounds per game. Number 1 in the nation. Number 1 in the offensive rebounding category, SEC and nation. Number 5 in the SEC in steals. Just a spectacular player. Spectacular senior season. Unfortunately, it's not going to finish better for her.
Well, and the hard part for Auburn is they need to score to set up the full court pressure. And that's their bread and butter, to turn you over. But if you don't score, you can't set it up. And so the made free throw by Unique Thompson, they set up the 2-2-1, and then active hands in the half court, they get the steal, and here they are now back to the free throw line.
Unique Thompson doing a job by herself of getting Georgia in foul trouble. So second consecutive trip to the free throw line. Thompson now with 11 of Auburn's 14 points. Number 1 in program history in double-doubles. She's got 12 this season. It seemed highly likely that she'll get another one here tonight. She averages a double-double. And Thompson forced it up there, got her own miss. Missed again. Stady with the defense. And Conley comes away with it.
And you can see UGA wants to push on those misses. They want to get down and try to score before the Auburn defense can get set.
Off the screen, bucket, Morrison.
Well, Matt, you alluded to the week-long break for UGA, and you got to remember that UGA was supposed to have a day off probably about 3 weeks ago, but because they were in South Carolina, they were ready to head to the gym when they got notification that the game was canceled. UGA drove back here to Stegman and practiced hard, had a live scrimmage. So this team has really not had a break until then. And I asked Joni Taylor, what was the focus? What was the emphasis these couple of days? And she said, we got a lot of shots up.
Thompson with the steal.
She can do it all.
13 points, 6 rebounds, a steal. Thompson doing her best to keep Auburn in this game, even though they're down 12. Charge is going to call, is going to be called on Koulibaly.
Well, we talked about how Q Morrison does a little bit of everything. There, she catches the freshman with her head down, just running the floor, draws the foul on Koulibaly, UGA ball. But I do have to also give Q Morrison credit for the roll as she drew the foul as well. That was very artistic.
So Georgia out to the big lead here, shooting 45% from the floor, Auburn at 29%. Georgia's hit 3 of 8 on their threes. Auburn has attempted only one, that by Scott Grayson. And Morrison. Koulibaly with the rebound.
Man, I think Koulibaly has such a tremendous upside. She was really an offensive bright spot in that loss at Auburn back in January. But she's having to play out of position this year just because Auburn lacks post step.
Georgia brings it up the floor. Koulibaly coming to Auburn from IMG Academy by way of Africa, a member of the under 16 Mali national team, averaged 22 points per game in the 2017 African Championship.
Well, Auburn showing why their coach believes in defense. Annie Hughes moving her feet, sliding as Q Morrison drops the shoulder to draw the charge.
Koulibaly. Thompson gets another rebound. And Coach Flo says Thompson's, you know, she's getting these rebounds with four or five players all around her. Morrison hits her second three-pointer of the game. That gives her double figures. First Georgia player to get to double digits. She's got 10 points, hit a couple of threes, and has four rebounds.
Well, Mac, back to your point, Auburn struggles from three. They're shooting 26%. So teams are packing it in, which makes it even more remarkable that Unique Thompson's able to get offensive rebounds.
So Q Morrison picking up where she left off at Alabama last week.
Q Morrison is just on fire. She's taking whatever the defense gives her. They leave her open. She's knocking it down from deep. UGA up 31-16.
I have the power to lower my blood sugar and A1C.
Because I can still make my own insulin. And Trulicity activates my body to release it, like it's supposed to.
Trulicity is for type 2 diabetes, not insulin, and I only need to take it once a week. Plus, it lowers the risk of cardiovascular events.
Trulicity isn't for people with type 1 diabetes or diabetic ketoacidosis. Don't take Trulicity if you're allergic to it, you or your family have medullary thyroid cancer, or have multiple endocrine neoplasia syndrome type 2. Stop Trulicity and call your doctor right away if you have an allergic reaction, a lump or swelling in your neck, severe pain, changes in vision, or diabetic retinopathy. Serious side effects may include pancreatitis. Taking Trulicity with sulfonylurea or insulin raises low blood sugar risk. Side effects include nausea, diarrhea, vomiting, belly pain, and decreased appetite, which lead to dehydration, may worsen or kidney problems.
I have it within me to lower my A1C.
Ask your doctor about Trulicity.
What? Welcome back to Stegman Arena, where UGA up big first quarter. Senior Q Morrison's been on fire, knocking it down from deep, taking what the defense gives her by reading, no rotation, I'm open, I'm ready to knock it down.
You know, and Christy, it's hard to believe this is the first time in her career she's had four straight double-figure scoring games. She hit that number here halfway through the second quarter with 10 points tonight.
Well, Q has always given effort. Any UGA fan will attest to that. Sometimes the effort just didn't show results. What we're seeing this year as a senior, we alluded to, she's healthy, but you're also seeing a confidence level. We see the smile so much more often this season, but you're seeing her ability that the game has slowed down. She can go faster, but she can pick you apart when the ball's in her hands, and she can eat you alive when she's on defense.
She's had the first two 20-plus point scoring games of her career here in her senior season. She's four times scored 15-plus points, which matches the number she had as a freshman and is actually more than she had in her sophomore and junior seasons combined.
And while running the point a lot this season compared to previous years.
Yeah, she leads the team in assists per game at 3.5. Of course, always still doing that defensive thing, tied for sixth in the SEC, just over 2 steals per game.
So, Matt, this is a period where Unique Thompson needs to get touches. I love the screen and pop that they just ran for her, because I feel like what happens is the young guards get frustrated and they just settle for easy looks, which is what their opponents want them to do.
15 of Auburn's 18 points from Unique Thompson.
I don't feel like we've sang her praises enough this evening. Did I miss something? Did she just change and lose the undershirt during the quarter break?
She might have. She's working hard. she's working up a sweat. 15 points, 7 rebounds, 6 of 15 from the floor. She's taken 15 of their 25 shots.
As someone who has covered Unique Thompson the last couple of years, my biggest pet peeve is she has not gotten the looks. She's had to earn shot opportunities by crashing the glass. So I'm a huge fan of these shot opportunities that she's had so far this game.
Look at Unique Thompson and the rest of the team. If only she had a little bit of help. Not getting it tonight. In honesty, Scott Grayson, who was coming off the 30 points, the career high against Missouri on Sunday, has yet to have an impact in this game. 1 of 4 from the floor and just 3 points.
Well, that's the downside when you've been on fire like honestly Scott Grayson has been. Teams are focusing on you. And that was one of the first things Joni Taylor said when we brought up Auburn. She goes, honestly, Scott Grayson's playing so well right now. So you knew that was going to be an emphasis in the game plan.
That was the second bucket of the game for Bates. Georgia up by 13. Koulibaly, the first player other than Scott Grayson and Thompson to score in this game. And we'll have a foul called on Auburn. This will be on Sanaya Wells. Q Morrison tonight, 10 points, 4 rebounds. Has committed 7 turnovers. 7 of the 13 turnovers for Georgia in this game have come from Q Morrison. And you look at Georgia, they're up by 11 and they've committed 13 turnovers. And as we've noted a number of times here, Georgia has very characteristically cleaned things up and been a much better team ball secure-wise in the second half.
Well, and I asked Joni Taylor about that a while ago, and she said, you know, I'm okay with the turnovers in transition because we're trying to play faster. She knows that there's going to be more than in years past. It's those half-court turnovers that have driven her crazy this season.
Q Morrison out-hustles the Auburn player to the ball. On the wing, Caldwell. Bates the rebound. Bates getting a lot of run here tonight.
Well, another young lady for UGA who's finally healthy, and you're seeing her confidence grow and her ability to play both ends of the floor and impact both ends of the court.
And Soisha Smith is also getting some run here tonight. She's already played 6 minutes. As you see, Bates, 4 points and 6 minutes of work this evening. And there's Soisha Smith. She's played 6 minutes and scored 3 points with a couple of rebounds.
Again, you just can't say enough about the depth of this UGA team when you have 9 players averaging 10-plus minutes a game, and we're seeing that in the post position, especially tonight. Already, Jenna Stady, Mallory Bakes, Jordan Isaacs, Zoisha Smith.
You see Georgia with their incredible 4 seniors, all of which have graduated and pursuing master's degrees. Unconfirmed reports that nobody else in the country has a team like that. 8 players averaging 15-plus minutes, 3 scoring 10-plus points per game. Very balanced team.
Well, and you look at next year's senior class, Joni Taylor's expecting 3 of those to be graduates that will be pursuing their graduate degree. So I think it speaks to the culture at UGA. I mean, in this day and age, how often do you even have 4-year players in your program anymore, with players wanting to transfer, looking for other opportunities? So, I mean, my hat goes off to not just these players, but obviously the coaching staff here as well.
Patton with the miss. They're still waiting for her junior college All-American with great credentials and accolades when she signed with Auburn. But as you know, Christy, first-year JUCO players, it's oftentimes a struggle. And it doesn't happen for them until that second year.
Well, Matt, when I was coaching, I always knew if you signed a JUCO player, you're really going to get one quality year from them. And that's not a knock on them, but they're freshmen all over again that junior year of college. And so it's learning, it's transitioning, and especially in a system like Auburn, where it's defensive and it's fast-paced, you can't be thinking to be good. It's got to be instinctual, and you have to have those reps. And that's where I think this Auburn team's going to continue to get better this season, but they're definitely a year away.
To the corner, and Patton with the three-pointer. First three-pointer for Auburn tonight. Patton starred at Wabash Valley Community College last season, averaging close to 21 points per game, 6.5 assists per game, 6 rebounds per game.
I do love how patient UGA is being in the half-court offense. They're not taking these quick shots. They're moving the ball side to side to pick apart that defense.
How about the pass from Coombs right there? Thread the needle to Bates.
Well, and that's a breakdown defensively, because if you watch UGA and scout them, you know that that's what they want to do. They want to seal that weak side of the low zone. That time, Mallory Bates left wide open for the two.
So Bates back at the line. And Georgia now 7-for-10 at the stripe tonight. And Bates will be one of those players next year that will be a fifth-year senior, will be a player that, you know, I'm not sure whether she's one of the graduates or not next year or not. She is one of the graduates next year. And, you know, a lot will be on Mallory Bates' shoulder next year because Jenna Stady will no longer be playing in front of her.
Well, I'm just going to put an asterisk on that because of the NCAA granting that additional year of eligibility.
That's Joni true.
Taylor told us that last time I asked her, she had not had those discussions with her four seniors. So who knows what this team could look like next year?
They'd be working on their doctorates.
Good point. Good point. Smart move by these young women if they could do that. And then you got to say the same thing for Unique Thompson. Right now with a salary cap, there's a lot of coaches who aren't quite sure with their rising seniors what's the best move for them. So, I mean, Unique Thompson also has that decision to make.
We go under a minute to play here in the second quarter. Georgia up by 13. Koulibaly ends up on the floor, and the tripping foul is going to be called on Smith. You see that rather bulky brace on Koulibaly's lower left leg. It can't be easy to play with that.
I'll be honest with you. Watching her warm up, I thought it was a brace that would come up to an. It is supposed to be on her knee.
It's supposed to, well, there you go. It's supposed to be on her knee.
It's a little less bulky when it's on the knee.
So Koulibaly at the line. Just a 54.5% free throw shooter, but cans the first. And Auburn now 7-of-9 at the free throw line tonight.
Koulibaly is just so explosive with the ball in her hands. I can't wait to see this young lady just continue to progress offensively.
Started the season in the starting lineup. She started the first three games for Auburn. Scored 10 points, 6 rebounds in their win against Gardner-Webb. And Georgia throws it away into the hands of Koulibaly. Break opportunity for the Tigers. And Rice, what's going to be the call here? Could be any number of things. And it's going to be on Rice. Elena Rice is called for the offensive foul.
A really late whistle by the official. I mean, I would have loved to just see Rice pull up for the pull-up jumper or hit maybe Unique Thompson on the trail, but definitely set there by Q Morrison.
I was thinking that she traveled, but on the replay, she didn't. She was called for a foul instead. Shot clock off for Georgia as we're down to our final 14 seconds of the half. Morrison. Rebound. And a jump ball is called with 0.3 seconds as Thompson got tied up by Smith.
Well, you got to believe this is going to be a little lob pass for Bates or someone to get a little tip in with 0.3 seconds to go on the clock.
Yeah, I don't think you can catch and shoot with 0.3. It's got to be a tip up like you're playing volleyball. And that's the end of the first half. But Georgia with a big lead, up by 11 in a game they need to win to stay pace with everybody else for fourth in the SEC. 11-point lead at the break.
Did you know GEICO could save you hundreds on car insurance and a whole lot more? So what are you waiting for? Hip-hop group tag team to help you plan dessert?
Fresh vanilla, rocky road, chocolate peanut butter cookie dough, scoop this.
GEICO, see all the ways you could save.
Wow, that's a low price.
Oh, wow, that's a low price.
What?
Ooh, that's a low price.
You're so good at low prices.
Yeah.
Circle back on that later.
Low price.
No, low price.
Douglas.
Price.
What's a low price?
I'm coming to it.
With everyday low prices at Amazon, anytime good to save.
Halftime here at Stegman Coliseum, number 24, Georgia leading Auburn 38-27. The Bulldogs have been very fortunate this season. They have managed the COVID protocols as well as any program in the nation. Here's Chuck Dowd-Oldmore.
Welcome back to the show. Behind me, Stegman Coliseum. It hosts men's and women's basketball, as well as gymnastics and some volleyball. So how do you prepare it so that it is totally safe during this COVID-19 era to protect fans as well as our student athletes?
I'm Matt Burkowski, Associate Athletic Director for Internal Operations. The discussions about Stegman Coliseum kind of occurred during the summer. Obviously our fall sports took precedent to get things ready for football, soccer, volleyball. But volleyball being in the Coliseum kind of pushed up that timeline a little bit. So once we got through probably the later part of the summer, started looking at the Coliseum to dictate what kind of plans need to put in place, how the seating bowl was going to be configured.
The NCAA, they set their regulations, and the SEC Medical Task Force set theirs. And then from what they gave us as regulations, we worked with how does that fit in our arena. It was conversations with different facility staff here as well as event management staff. We met with the basketball teams. We kind of came up with our plan, and then we went to the conference office and presented our diagram and our plan. Every arena is different, so you can't have the same thing at every school, but we just had to make with what they gave us how it could work with our arena.
A lot of discussions with both Josh, obviously, with a seating plan, with our ticket office, with basketball and gymnastics coming up soon, our facilities office, many different people kind of run that process to figure out what we needed to do for the Coliseum.
We made a decision when we decided to have a season that we would operate, number one, with the health and safety of our players and our staff first. And that means during timeouts, we also sit 6 feet apart. And so everyone might not hear the message or the tweak. And then we have to do just a really, really good job of passing that message down the bench once play resumes.
A lot of times on the bench, I'm not sure if the camera can see, but I'm squinting my eyes like really hard, like that's gonna help me hear, which it doesn't. But it's been an adjustment, but I can easily go up to any of my teammates or my coaches and they're great. They just repeat what they had to say to begin with.
So some of the things we've had to do is just making sure that we've had to be able to move some of our people because there's certain people that have to be at certain spots on the scorer's table. So we worked with our sports communication staff on figuring out where we can move people and who can be in what locations.
Yeah, also the biggest difference is the movement of our team benches.
All these bench chairs, this is what is now moved to our bench area. Our bench area just used to be one row of seats, but now it has become three rows, as well as coming over to two rows.
That allowed us to have more space to make sure that all the seats were 6 feet apart, because we spend a lot of time, obviously, on the sidelines, and we want to make sure that we're following all the CDC protocols. And so we now have three rows of bench seats and a yellow, we call it the yellow box area, another area for our extended staff who cannot fit on the bench. So I believe we have 22 chairs on the bench. They're all spaced out appropriately to make sure that nobody is closer than 6 feet apart.
Well, there's a lot of things that go on behind the scenes that people don't see, just on the sanitation and the cleaning process that we now have to go through. The time that we have for people to get in the facility, even though the much reduced capacity, we're leaving a lot of that time still so people can come in when they want. So that's a little more less people in congestion on the concourse. Just the spacing within the stands, you know, the guidelines that are in place by the conference in our local community, trying to enforce those the best we can. to make it an atmosphere that people feel safe and comfortable to be in.
I cannot tell you the number of emails, phone calls, and text messages that we've gotten from our fans and from parents and from season ticket holders who have said, this was the first time I came out since quarantine to a public event and I felt so safe. Our family felt safe. We had to get used to where the seats were, but we were so glad that we came, and we're so glad that the University of Georgia and the Athletic Association is taking all the necessary steps and protocols that they are to make us feel safe.
I think our athletes and our coaches have done a great job of taking this seriously and staying 6 feet apart, masking up. They stay socially distanced during the anthem, socially distanced during their timeouts. So I think that they've really tried to be very conscious of this, which is why we've been so successful.
What we're trying to do is just make that environment that's enticing for people to come to events, make them comfortable. Certainly, I mean, we know fans want to come to the events. All our tickets are sold. And just making that atmosphere so where they're comfortable when they get here is something that we're trying to strive for.
Halfway to 7-4 in the SEC, leading Auburn 38-27 here at halftime. 24th-ranked Lady Bulldogs on top. Matt Stewart joined by Coach Christy Thomas-Cuddy. And Coach, Georgia's committed 8 more turnovers than Auburn, but Georgia leads by 11 because they've hit 4 more threes.
Well, and not just that, they've doubled Auburn up on the glass, so they've created their own extra scoring opportunities, but they're also shooting 45% from the field.
Auburn shooting only 30% from the floor. Georgia has out-rebounded Auburn as well, 28-14. And Georgia averages only 4 threes per game. They've already hit 5 in the game.
Well, some of that is because of the changing defenses of Auburn. And credit UGA, because they've been willing to make the extra pass, finding who's open. And Jenna Stady's knocked it down. Gabby Conley's been able to knock it down. Q Morrison, they moved the ball side to side, forcing rotations from the Auburn defense. Hasn't mattered if it's been a 1-3-1, a 2-3, or a 3-2. UGA's been ready to shoot.
Q Morrison with 2 of Georgia's 5 three-pointers. And where would Auburn be right now without Unique Thompson?
A huge uphill climb. Unique has done this evening what Unique has always done, and that's because she's just simply unique. She moves without the ball so well. Credit Auburn. They've done a couple of curl screens that's allowed her to get downhill and flash to the ball. But other than that, it's just been Unique Thompson showing numbers, presenting herself, a little reverse pivot to create space. But the bottom line, Matt, is she has just wanted the ball. She's been very controlled and composed, and she's knocked them down when she's got clean looks.
She has 15 of Auburn's 27 points, so over 50%. She has 7 of their 14 rebounds, so 50%. She's taken 16 of their 30 shots, over 50%, while Georgia's been much more balanced with Q Morrison leading the way, 10 points and 6 rebounds.
Well, honestly, it's what we expect when you see Auburn coming into this game. And I do believe that Auburn, it could be worse if Unique Thompson's not getting as many touches as she's had. For the perimeter players of Auburn, they need to try to create off the bounce. And not just for their own shots, set one another up, create turnovers, and get out in transition to create those easy scoring opportunities. But for UGA, they just need to take care of the basketball, plain and simple, because when they've gotten the ball in the half court, they've been very successful.
And Georgia has been, this season, a better team taking care of the ball in the second half. Usually a high number of turnovers in the first half. That's been the case here again tonight with 16 turnovers. But this is what Georgia has typically done, and they'll come back and have only 4 or 5 turnovers in the second half. You should take a look at the statistical first half breakdown, and, you know, the 8 turnovers for Auburn, 16 for Georgia, you would think that would have a greater impact on the game, but it hasn't.
Well, and that, again, I'll say, it's one thing to turn a team over. You've got to be able to convert, and that's where we haven't seen Auburn consistently be able to create those easy scores off the turnovers. And the bottom line, if you're Auburn and you struggle to score, you've got to create extra possessions. How do you do that? You turn the opponent over, and you attack the offensive glass.
So Unique Thompson, can she get some help from teammates like Honesty Scott Grayson, who has scored only 3 points in this game? Kia Patton has scored only 3 points in this game. Koulibaly has scored 4 points in this game. Who will step up from Auburn to help out Unique Thompson and try to get the Tigers back in the game and get them their first SEC win of the season?
Well, already good for Auburn. They had the rush shot, but they got back in transition defense. But UGA can also score in the half-court offense with Jenna Stady with a reverse pivot jumper.
Stady with her third basket. She has 7 points in the game. And that's one of the things Coach Flo was preaching to us the other day. She said, look, we got to do the things that we can do to try to win the game, control the game. The things we can do is not throw the ball into the passing lane, obviously, where Georgia's going to be jumping into the passing lane and stealing the ball. And the other thing we can do is we can sprint back on defense, not backpedal.
Well, Matt, one thing that I always had trouble with when I had young teams was transition defense, because it's effort and communication. And that's where you see breakdowns so many times for Auburn, is that you just got five players doing their own thing versus working together. And again, we talked about UGA wants to push the tempo, but UGA is very comfortable in the half court. And why wouldn't you be when you got a post player like Jenna Stady to anchor the offense?
Calls for the ball, 6 on the shot clock. Drive, shoots over Unique Thompson, and Levy with the rebound. Long outlet goes to Scott Grayson. She'll pull up and miss the shot.
And that's the part of Scott Grayson's game that I would love to see her take it to the rim or elevate and go straight up. She has that little fadeaway that she just struggles to convert with.
Consecutive rebounds for Levy. Romy Levy, she has been conspicuously quiet tonight, no points. Did not score when they played Georgia the first time, but did have a career-high 6 steals.
Levy's one of those players, I feel like you look at the stat sheet after a game and you're just like, wow, because she'll have the steals or she'll have the rebounds. She'll do a lot of little things, but she's a stat filler, basically. But yes, you hit it on the head. Auburn needs her to be able to convert a couple of these baskets.
And Thompson got blocked by Stady. And the rebound by Stady.
Well, notice how many pink jerseys are in the paint when Unique Thompson catches the ball. They're just crowding it, not giving her space to really work and operate.
That's one of the things that's made her season so extraordinary. Everybody knows that the offense and the rebounds are going to come from her, and she just keeps getting it.
Well, and honestly, the only thing that's stopped Unique Thompson this season has been foul trouble. There she picks up her second foul.
Jordan Isaacs at the line, looking for her first points of the night. She really has been a glue player for Georgia. She has been the outlier out of the 4 graduate seniors getting their masters. She's the only underclassman who's been in the starting lineup every game this season. But the Georgia coaching staff will tell you they really rely on her on defense or communication to help out Stady on the rotations.
Well, you've got 4 other consistent scorers, so you need that player that can just do a little bit of everything as Q Morrison gets out in transition and scores. But we know Johnny Taylor's always been a defense-first coach, and so you've got to have that player like Jordan Isaacs on the floor to help you be successful.
Levy, that was the first shot that she's taken in this game. Bullet pass, and Morrison can't hold on to it.
Q Morrison getting out, running the transition lane for the easy 2. UGA keeping the pressure on Georgia.
On March 5th.
How did this world get so broken?
I believe that we can be unified again, but someone has to take the first step.
All right, Tuk Tuk. Let's roll!
From the studio that brought you Frozen.
Hold on.
Oh, we were doing a jumpy thing. Oh, so sorry, my bad.
Raya and the Last Dragon. Rated PG. In theaters or order it on Disney Plus with Premier Access. March 5th.
I think the sketchy website about this turtle stole all my info.
Ooh, have you looked on the bright side?
Governor never holds you responsible for unauthorized purchases on your card. That's my turtle.
Fraud protection. Discover something brighter.
The NCAA Women's Basketball Championship on ESPN.
It's Jackson on the drive for the lead. Got it to go. And that's it. The Baylor Lady Bears at the top of college basketball.
About a month away from the selection of the NCAA tournament field for the women's NCAA championships to be bubbled in San Antonio. And here are the eight teams that Charlie Cream projects as of right now would make the tournament.
Well, even with South Carolina losing on Monday, he still got them as a solid one seed. A&M's the tricky one right now. With their final game being at South Carolina, with a win there, could they potentially move up higher? And then with UGA, I mean, the bottom line for UGA, they have no bad losses. They have three solid wins right now over Arkansas, Georgia Tech, as well as Tennessee.
Yeah.
And so, you know, for UGA, they just need to keep playing quality basketball down the stretch.
And did you take a look at Charlie Cream's latest bracketology this week? Of course, the regions aren't broken up down by East and West. It's just region 1, 2, 3, and 4 because it's all going to be in San Antonio. But in region 3, where he has Georgia projected as the 4 seed, he has Georgia Tech projected as the 5 seed, meaning theoretically, if his projection came true, they'd be playing in the second round.
A rematch of the overtime game,
exactly,
is what you're saying. Yeah, I mean, the bottom line for any team, especially after not having a tournament a year ago, is they want in. They want the opportunity. And we said it in the open, if you're UGA who's been playing well all season, you just want to keep positioning yourself for the easiest path to victory game in and game out.
And not just a rematch of the overtime game. You're talking about Georgia, Georgia Tech playing in the NCAA tournament against each other. It'd be the first time it had ever happened.
Well, if you live in the state of Georgia, it's the way it should be, right? Nell Fortner now has Georgia Tech playing high-caliber basketball again within the ACC. They're in third place in the ACC going into tonight. And then Joni Taylor's just, what a tremendous year for the Lady Bulldogs.
Well, that would certainly be special. The only thing that would be disappointing for Georgia is that typically they would be playing, hopefully, those first two rounds here at Stegman Coliseum. They would get, theoretically, a Georgia Tech 5 seed, them as the 4 seed here in their building in the second round of the NCAA tournament. If it does happen that way, it'll be in San Antonio.
Well, I mean, I think if you ask any of the players on either team, any of the coaches, they just want to play. And so many questions still remain. The good news, because we don't even know about fan attendance, every game will be broadcasted by ESPN. And so at this point, continue to control what you can control, and that's get W's, put yourself in a good position to get the highest seed possible.
Levy, first basket of the game for Romy Levy. And you were talking about her being a stat stuffer, and she has been. They haven't gotten the full all-around game from her just yet, and they believe that's going to come. Thought we had a whistle, but apparently not, and Scott Grayson takes it in for the layup. Auburn has cut it to 10. This is as close as they have been in quite some time.
Well, we talked about how Unique Thompson missed the first three games of SEC action. Romy Levy played the 5 during that period of time for them. I mean, just high basketball IQ. And so that's the one thing Coach Flo has said. We can move her around. It hasn't necessarily been putting her in the best position possible, but it's what we've needed to be successful.
So out of that timeout, Auburn has made a little bit of a run here while Georgia's missed their last 4 shots. It's a 10-point game here in the third quarter.
I think the sketchy website I bought this turtle from stole all my info.
Ooh. Have you looked on the bright side?
Discover never holds you responsible for unauthorized purchases on your card.
That's my turtle.
Fraud protection. Discover something brighter.
How do we ensure families, food insecurity, get access to their food? We needed to make sure that if they couldn't get to the food would come to them. We can deliver for food banks and schools. Amazon knows how to do that. I've helped deliver 12 million meals to families in need.
That's the power of having a company like Amazon behind me.
Welcome back, Stegman Coliseum. For more Black history, always storytelling. Visit theundefeated.com. Check this out. One of greatest stars of the past. Bernadette Maddox had a chat with Georgia's stars of the present.
Take the things that you've learned from Georgia and do you. And I know you guys have seen that commercial that says, see her. If you see those females out there, and you guys have, there's ESPN, there's females from the University of Georgia, and you aspire to be whatever it is you want to be in life, you can do that. See her, be her. You can do those things. Whatever you put your mind to do, you can do it.
And Matt, I had a chance to ask Joni Taylor about Bernadette Maddox's just impact. And she said she distinctly remembers as a player at Alabama looking over and seeing Bernadette when she was the head coach at Kentucky. She said, I get chills thinking about it today. She was being able to watch someone who looks like you accomplish so much really served as an inspiration to me and a lot of other young black women. Without Bernadette, I am not sure the SEC would have 7 black female coaches like we do today.
And is no doubt a much different world in women's college athletics and women's basketball now compared to when Bernadette Maddox stepped onto the floor here for the University of Georgia in 1979, and especially for African-American athletes.
Well, hey Matt, at the end of the day, representation matters. And so for any young woman, I mean, you hope this generation doesn't even notice that it's just who we are now in the SEC. That would be the greatest compliment you can give anyone. But, I mean, here's the crazy thing. Bernadette Maddox has not aged a day. That, I just want to know what she does.
She was an assistant coach at the age of 8. In 1990-94, she was on Rick Pitino's staff. And you saw the photo of her sitting next to eventual NBA star Jamal Mashburn, coaching him up on the bench there at Rupp Arena. And then became the Kentucky women's basketball head coach as well. But when she became a coach on the men's staff at Kentucky under Rick Pitino, you talk about breaking a glass ceiling, a ceiling that's still not all the way broken.
Unfortunately, I mean, we have tons of males on the women's side. Right now that I'm aware of, there's only one other female on the men's collegiate side. We have 2 in the NBA assistant coaches, and so it's starting to change. I'm sorry, 3, I should say. It's starting to change, but it's just still rather slow. And you just can't say enough about just the courage for Bernadette to go over and coach on the men's side. And you got to credit Andy Landers for encouraging her to do that. I love the story, though. She said she's sitting in her office because she was an assistant under Andy Landers at the time. And the phone rang, and it was Tubby Smith. And she thought he had dialed the wrong number. And, you know, she was like, oh, you know, I'm so sorry. I can get you to the right person. He goes, oh, no. Rick Pitino wants to know if you would like to join our staff as an assistant coach. And so my hat goes off to Bernadette Maddox for having the courage, first and foremost, because I think like so many of these trailblazers, they didn't know it in the moment, but they just did what they thought they wanted to do or needed to do, and here we are all these years later. And I agree 100% with Joni Taylor. I don't think we have 7 black female coaches in the SEC without a pioneer like Bernadette.
No doubt about it. Georgia's back up to a 16-point lead here. Scott Grayson having a tough night. Now 3 of 12 shooting the ball.
Well, it's just shot selection. You don't want to force a contested shot against a much taller UGA team because what happens is it leads to runouts.
And that's exactly what Georgia has done here. They've taken what was a 10-point lead at our last time out and expanded it to 18. 8-0 run for Georgia with 3 minutes to play here in this third quarter. Georgia trying to at least stick in the race for that top 4 seed in the SEC tournament. And what that means, a double bye, means you don't have to play until the quarterfinals. And Georgia started the night in a 3-way tie for the 4th spot with Kentucky and with LSU. Kentucky and Tennessee right now battling it out at Memorial Gym. Missouri and number 1 South Carolina in a real battle tonight as well in Columbia. And LSU was trailing Florida last time we checked.
Well, Mizzou shot 54% in the first half, tied at halftime, but now South Carolina's gone on a run to be up 10. LSU has closed the gap. They're now down only 5. The game to watch that I'm really paying attention to is Ole Miss at Alabama. Alabama clawed their way back, but now Ole Miss is back up to a 7-point lead. Now, again, we don't want everybody changing the channel, but we can keep you updated here. Yeah, but there's a lot of quality SEC action going on tonight.
Since you're at the update desk, what was the score on Kentucky-Tennessee? It was 11. The Wildcats were up 11 on the Lady Vols at one point, right?
44-39 okay. At this point, Tennessee.
So down to five. So Georgia pulling for Tennessee, I guess, if you will, and Florida. If those games could go their way, Georgia could be in fourth place all by themselves by the end of the night.
Well, there's a lot of important games in the next week because the league announced today the makeup between Mississippi State and Tennessee will be played next Tuesday. So that's another game that indirectly or directly, depending on how you look at it, will affect UGA seeding.
Some nice backdoor action right there. Scott Grayson now with 9 points in the game. Conley launches the three. Battle for the ball, and Georgia comes away with it. Caldwell puts it on the floor and pulls up mid-range. Caldwell now in double figures. She's got 10 points and 8 rebounds. She's close to a double-double.
So, Matt, Gabby Conley takes the three, and it's a weak contest because she can put it on the floor and create. Then the ball gets reversed back around to Maya Caldwell, a hard closeout, and she puts it on the floor and drives right by the defender for the two. That's where, again, we see the versatility of UGA this season.
You know, and Maya Caldwell is one of those players. You mentioned that she scored 13 in the second half at Alabama last Thursday night, but look at her line here tonight. 10 points, 8 rebounds, 5 assists. She has really become a solid player, and she's been in the starting lineup, so it's not surprising. But what I guess what I'm trying to say is out of all the players who get publicity out of that starting lineup outside of Jordan Isaac, she might be the one who gets the fewest.
Well, it's so funny because I really believe her game at Alabama was the best game that I can remember her having in the last couple of years. And I'm not just talking stats and points. She was just active on both ends of the court. And we've seen that time and time again this season, her ability to defend. I think at times she could get lost on defense in years past. You're seeing her just experience now on the floor on defense. And then on offense, she could always score. She's much more of a slasher. But she's able to mix it up and basically take what the defense gives you. That last possession that I referred to, hard closeout, well, I'm going to blow by you and do the pull-up.
Well, she's now one rebound away from her first career double-double. Final minute of this third quarter. Patton. Now Rice behind the three-point line. And Georgia up the floor. Smith driving, hard basket off the back iron and straight up and in. I don't think they're going to count it, though. They're going to call a charge, are they not?
That's what the official, a little late on the whistle, but calls a charge. And Joni Taylor can't believe it. Hands immediately went to her head like, are you kidding me? Well, first of all, you got to give hats off to your post player, Zoisha Smith, taking it in transition. And there is a bump, but she's in the restricted arc.
Yeah, she's in the arc.
And it was so after Zoisha Smith had left the ground. Honestly, yeah. Matt, that's one of those calls. You're up 55-37. So I appreciate that Jonah Taylor's like, doesn't matter. You messed up.
Yeah, if it's a tighter ball game, you're no doubt going to argue that a little bit more.
The replay was just played in Stegman, and so the fans also just got to weigh in on that call.
Yeah, there were several things, in my opinion, wrong with that call. Number one, the defender moved in underneath Smith after Smith was already off her feet. And number two, she was in the restricted zone.
Now's when I wish we had the air bubble thoughts above Joni Taylor, because I would love to know, first of all, what she said to the official, but just what she's thinking. I mean, to me, worst case for your UGA, that basket should count, because it was already going through the cylinder right. When he blew the whistle and there was contact.
Oh, the shot was off before the foul, that's for sure. Take another look at this, and you'll see, okay, so she's in the air, and, well, she was actually back down and came down and ran into her.
You know, watching the replay again, you can almost argue she wasn't even set defensively, because it looked like she was going sideways at the time.
Yeah. Like you said, with an 18-point lead, you're just unhappy about that, not furious.
Well, Matt, once again, whether I'm still coaching or not, the officials don't care what I think.
Patton open in the corner. Thompson had the rebound, had it stolen away by Coombs. Georgia can run here with 14 seconds left in the third quarter, and now play for the final shot.
And UGA has had the ball at the end of each quarter. So far, 0 for 2 on the night. Can they convert here?
Conley drops it off for Nicholson. Nicely done. And Georgia will take a 20-point lead to the fourth quarter. Georgia taking care of business tonight here at Stegman Coliseum.
I think the sketchy website I bought this turtle from stole all my info.
Ooh. Have you looked on the bright side?
Discover never holds you responsible for unauthorized purchases on your card.
That's my turtle.
Fraud protection. Discover something brighter.
Start of the fourth quarter, number 24, Georgia West here leading Auburn 57-37. And we start this fourth quarter, Maya Caldwell, one rebound shy of her first double-double.
You know, Matt, Joni Taylor said that this team is really hard to scout because anybody can beat you on any given night. Well, tonight, Maya Caldwell has shown up big. She's moved to the corner against the zone, been wide open, knocked it down when it's been her chance. Bad closeout, she blows by for the pull-up jump shot.
Not only 10 points, 9 rebounds, but also 5 assists for Maya Caldwell in 26 minutes of work tonight. She is one of 2 Lady Bulldogs to score in double figures. Q Morrison also making a little history for herself tonight with her 4th consecutive double figure game, 14 points, and she too is close to a double-double. 14 points and 8 rebounds and kind of a triple-double too with counter 7 turnovers, but we won't do that.
Well, 19 points in that quarter for UGA, and you said over the break, they just did a better job of taking care of the ball. After those 16 first-half turnovers, only 4 in that quarter. So, and we said it from the beginning, if UGA can take care of the ball, they're going to get high-percentage looks. Unfortunately, they start the quarter with another turnover.
5 for Georgia here in the second half after 16 in the first half, but you look at it, they've committed that many turnovers, yet they lead by 20. Georgia's hit 6 more three-pointers. That's 18 points right there, so do the math. 6 more three-pointers than Auburn in this game. Unique Thompson, the miss. Thompson now has a double-double, 15 points and 10 rebounds.
I mean, you got to credit Auburn. They've executed that backdoor play well. They just couldn't finish at the rim, but UGA has consistently here tonight.
Just think about the significance of the Unique Thompson accomplishment here, her 55th career double-double tonight. We're talking about Maya Caldwell, 4th-year player, on the verge of getting her first career double-double. Q Morrison's close to her first double-double of the season. Unique Thompson has 55 of those in her career.
You know, you want consistency as a coach, and anytime I've asked Coach Flo about Unique, she says she's just unique because she said from day one, she's just gone to work. You can coach her hard. She takes what you give her. And Coach Flo is very honest. She goes, you know, those first 3 games of SEC play, it wasn't just her physical ability on the court that we missed. We missed her presence in the locker room, on the sideline, her voice with these young players. And I'll just say, as a fan, I have loved watching this young lady play the last 4 years because she's a throwback. She's a true back to the basket. She's extended her range this season to help prepare herself for professional basketball. Right. But for a young lady who so many games doesn't get touches, she still shows up. She still goes to work as testament to the 55 double-doubles.
Scott Grayson will go to the foul line. 11 points for Scott Grayson tonight after her 30 and career high against Missouri on Sunday, averaging 16 points per game in conference play. That gets her to 12.
So Auburn extending the full court pressure, the 1-2-2 now after the made free throw.
And the left-handed layup by Smith.
Well, great patience by UGA. They moved the ball to the sideline. Then they get the middle flash, and that's the one thing when you're pressing, you do not want to allow the ball to go to the middle. Great job by Smith to finish.
Well, it's got to be difficult for Coach Flo, who's taken six teams to the NCAA tournament, three at Georgetown, three here at Auburn. She's had great success in her career as a coach, to be going through this type of season here in 2021. She says, we don't beat them down in practice. We're totally positive. I preach to my team all the time that their record does not define who they are.
Well, earlier this season, I called her Zen Flo because she just seems so relaxed. And she's realistic. She knows she has a lot of new faces. They didn't have the summer or the preseason to truly get this defense in for these players to get the reps. And I've always been a big believer of that, especially when it comes late January, February. Teams can play to what their record is, or they can play to their potential. And this Auburn team has not hung their head and played to their record yet. And they keep trying to battle. But right now, UGA's just moving the ball so well against that zone.
That was almost Harlem Globetrotter-esque, the way that was whipped around. Nice passing by Georgia on that play. And the finish over the shoulder by Nicholson.
So who's Curly then for UGA?
Curly Neal, one of the legends of basketball. Caldwell misses the three-point shot. .23 lead for Georgia as we go under seven to play. Lady Bulldogs will, in all likelihood, improve to 15-4 on the season, 7-4 in the conference. And it's another one of those seasons where Georgia is going to finish higher than their preseason prediction in the SEC. It's kind of become a thing with Joni Taylor, and she had a wry smile on her face when we mentioned that to her in our Zoom call. As you take a look at the SEC standings, these are the top eight teams, and Georgia currently tied with Kentucky and LSU for the number four spot.
What of those eight teams? Seven of them are projected to be in the NCAA tournament right now. LSU had a tough non-conference schedule, had a losing record, so they're still in the mix to play their way in right now, currently one of the first four out, but that's how tough it is in the SEC, game in and game out.
A loss to Florida tonight certainly would not help their cause, but you're right, they are currently tied for fourth in the SEC standings, but their net ranking is 62 because they went 1-4 in non-conference play.
I mean, LSU down right now to Florida, but they still have to go this season. They go to South Carolina this Sunday. They have Kentucky. They have Arkansas. They have Mississippi State. So the opportunity is there for LSU, but opportunity means nothing if you don't win.
Monique Thompson does not convert the three-point play. So she's at 17 points, 11 rebounds, almost exactly on her per-game averages. She averages 13 boards a game in Georgia over and back. Coombs was in the backcourt when she touched the pass back to her. Quiet night for Coombs, 18 scoreless minutes tonight with three assists, three rebounds, three turnovers.
Well, and a lot of times it's Q Morrison or Gabby Conley passing ahead to Coombs in transition. Today, the bigs have got involved in transition and running, and so Coombs hasn't been that lead pass.
And Georgia with the steal. Maya Caldwell missed the opportunity right there. Georgia battles for the loose ball and tied up. And the possession arrow is pointing in Georgia's direction. No, Auburn's direction, pardon me. From our concourse position, it's hard to figure out which way the officials are pointing sometimes. Or at least it is for me.
But how nice is it just to be a part of live basketball?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. To be in the arena.
Limited capacity, but you know what? You can still hear the sneakers. You can just hear the players, and there's just an energy. I'm sorry. I mean, like, for someone who was worried we wouldn't have basketball, I'm just a kid in a candy store every time I can watch live basketball.
Stady got the block, but somebody fouled Thompson. Was it Stady? I don't believe it was on Stady.
Then they got Conley. Gabby Conley.
Yeah, her fourth.
Consecutive misses for Unique Thompson, who is typically a very good free throw shooter. Came in number three in the SEC, over 81%. Bates dribbled it off her foot. So that gets Georgia to 25 turnovers in this game.
And they already, I mean, they came in SEC action averaging 18, which to win 9 in and 9 out in the SEC, I'm a big believer it's got to be around 15. Now, again, UGA pushes tempo. You're willing to eat that up a little bit. But by no means is Joni Taylor going to be happy with the 25.
Well, it just flies in the face of conventional wisdom as Auburn turns it over on the travel that you could have 25 turnovers in a game yet still be winning by 20.
Well, we've said it. Anytime UGA's been able to break the pressure, take care of it, and get a shot opportunity, they've been successful. I mean, they're still shooting 45% for the game, and they're almost double the rebound battle. So, again, basketball is a game of possessions. You may turn it over a lot, but if you can get the second chance opportunities or minimize your opponent's opportunities, you're going to have a great chance to win night in and night out.
Third three-pointer of the night for Conley. She now is in double figures. Four Lady Bulldogs in double figures. Conley has 11. Hughes on the drive, wraparound pass to Kubali, and the basket and one.
3-year Gabby Conley, the best three-point shooter on UGA's team, knocks it down for her third three of the night. UGA up 66-45.
I think the sketchy website I bought this turtle from stole all my info.
Ooh, have you looked on the bright side?
Discover never holds you responsible for unauthorized purchases on your card.
That's my turtle.
Fraud protection. Discover something brighter.
With another double-double tonight, 8 points, 11 rebounds, and quite frankly, nothing unique about that at all, the 55th of her career. Another solid night from the Auburn senior, but not going to be enough to top Georgia as the Lady Bulldogs lead by 21.
Well, Matt, outstanding, but absolutely not unique, and I just can't sing this young lady's praises enough. Against multiple post players that UGA has thrown at her throughout the night, she stayed true to who she is, and that's just a workhorse. And she's pounded the glass, trying to keep Auburn in this game.
Meantime, while she has picked up her 55th career double-double, Maya Caldwell has officially picked up her first, got a rebound in there, so she's now got 10 points and 10 rebounds. Back door to Conley over her head, and turnover number 26. You see hands on head for Joni Taylor. You gotta wonder, what would be the record for most turnovers in a victory? In a 20-point victory. It's got to be some kind of a record. It'd be a deep dive for that to figure that one out.
Honestly, no coach is happy with that win. Again, you're happy that you won, but no player's going to be happy the next day in practice after that win. We'll just leave it at that.
You suggesting sprints?
Joni Taylor knows right now they're going to win this game. This is not about winning this game at this point. It is about creating positive momentum as they get ready to go on the road to a very difficult Columbia to play, take on Mizzou. So you just want positive momentum. Yes, you want the W, but create positive winning habits right now. And being careless with the ball is not one of those.
Stady got another block in there. So Stady now with 7 blocks in the game. And she now has pushed up over 60 blocks for the season. She's at 61. Conley just fouled out. That's foul number 5 on her. And Stady will come out of the game, and Davenport will check in for the first time.
So, Matt, you asked earlier, how do you turn the ball over 26 times and you win? Well, just look at some of the remarkable stats. You talked about Maya Caldwell's double-double. Jenna Stady with 7 rebounds. The threes by Gabby Conley. This is why I say this UGA team is so difficult to play, because they can beat you in so many different ways. They can make things difficult for you in so many different ways. And they haven't even really put up high-pressure defense tonight by extending it. They've really relied on the half-court defense.
You know, we've talked about Georgia battling for a top 4 seed in the SEC tournament. It's also one of those things, be careful what you wish for, because as the number 4 seed, that means if you advance to the semifinals, you play South Carolina. And eventually you will play South Carolina if you stay in the tournament long enough.
Well, and again, this is where UGA had a low in that game, really outplayed South Carolina in that fourth quarter in Columbia last month. So I do think it's a good matchup for UGA. By no means am I saying it's an easy matchup, but they definitely have to take better care of the ball. And I've said this all season long for UGA. They take care of the ball, they've got a chance to win every night. If they're this careless with the ball, it could be a long night against other competition.
Now, interesting dilemma for Joni Taylor. You see the final 4 games on Georgia's schedule at Missouri, then Tennessee here, Kentucky here. Those are 2 teams that are ahead of them in the standings. Then they wrap up at Florida. Because Vanderbilt has canceled the rest of their season, Georgia gets another break in the rotation next Thursday. They had a break in the rotation this past Sunday. That means by the time they play Tennessee, they will have played, I believe, only 2 games in 16 days.
But, Matt, I'll foreshadow longer, because we know there's postseason for this team. I think the break is needed and good. I think right now you got to make shots. You got to be able to be mentally strong. And I do think when they went to Alabama last week, I saw fatigue. Like, just watching some of the movements and cuts, and this is fatigue, mental fatigue as much as physical. Luckily, UGA has such a deep bench that it really never was exposed, but you got to stay fresh. And we already know how long the season's been for everyone mentally and physically. So I think a break would be good for UGA.
Well, Georgia's been going since June. They came here in June. You didn't get the typical, well, they did take a little bit of a Christmas break, and I mean a little bit of a Christmas break, but it's been a pretty long haul, consistent stretch of working out and meeting and following protocols since June. And I don't disagree with you. I think the break is great for Georgia at this time of year. My line of thinking and questioning is more of how does Georgia treat this time off. Obviously, you want to get rest for mind and body, but also how do you take advantage of this time to try to improve your game, cut down on the turnovers, which tonight it's not going to hurt them against those teams like Tennessee and Kentucky, teams they'll face in the SEC tournament, and ultimately in the NCAA tournament they will. It'll hurt them.
Well, I think, first of all, you're not having to focus on another team in prep, so you can focus on yourself and really work on some of those drills. And Matt, you hit it on the head. As you look at postseason, your margin of error shrinks. When you get into the SEC tournament, your margin of error shrinks to where it's one possession and you could lose a game. Mm-hmm. And so those are things, there's film now. You can teach with that. You've done good things you could show. There's obviously bad things you can show. And so it's learning opportunities. And just, I imagine, just like Jody Taylor and staff approach this game, they will take Monday off after the Mizzou game, maybe practice Tuesday, maybe take another day or two off, and then really get into a deep prep as they welcome Tennessee to town.
Hose comes in firing off the bench and cans the 3-pointer. Good for Caitlin Hose. Just the 4th 3-pointer of the season for her, and of course, playing in memory of her grandmother who passed away last week, and she stayed behind after the game in Tuscaloosa to be a part of the funeral services for her grandmother. Koulibaly with the miss. Now look at this extraordinary number. This kind of tells the story of the game. Georgia has committed 27 turnovers. Auburn has scored 18 points off of them. Georgia scored nearly as many points off of the Auburn turnovers, even though Auburn has half as many turnovers.
Well, and when I asked Coach Flo about that, she goes, that's the problem. We're still, they still lead the SEC in turnovers. I think they're 28th in the country in forced turnovers, but they cannot consistently turn those into points. And it's disheartening. I mean, you work so hard defensively to create those scoring opportunities, and yet you can't convert.
17 of 61 collectively from the floor tonight, and 1 of 10 on their threes. Georgia's made up a 24-point difference in this game in three-point shooting. 9 three-pointers made for Georgia on 21 attempts. Auburn 1 for 10, so there's an 8-basket differential on the three-point shot here tonight. That's 24 points. There's your game right there. I mean, Georgia is a team that averages only 4 threes per game, so they've more than doubled their per-game average behind the three-point line as Hose takes another, and Coombs gets the rebound.
And just so wisely, just pulls it out. Let's reset the zone offense.
Scott Grayson, 5 of 15 from the floor tonight, 12 points. The Baylor star, former Baylor star, transfer to Auburn. McDonald's All-American out of New Jersey. Going to be such a big part of the future here for this Auburn program. Wow, what a night for Caldwell. 3 three-pointers now for her, 13 points, 10 rebounds, 6 assists, her first career double-double.
You know, when I asked Joni Taylor how important the Alabama win was, she said, you know, going into it, we needed Maya Caldwell to start playing better for us. Well, she's just picked up from the Alabama game, and she's continuing there, which bodes well for this UGA team as they try to get ready for tournament play.
Final minute. Thompson comes up with the steal from Bates. Koulibaly had her shot blocked by Bates in a nasty way. Just utter disregard for her shot right there.
Well, we talk about the half-court defense, and it's easy to get your perimeters out and to be aggressive when you got shot blockers like Mallory Bates and Jenna Stady to protect the rim.
Three ball for Auburn. 18 points. The deficit as we go under 40 seconds to play here.
And how about Mallory Bates now facing up and doing a turnaround jumper?
Sweet. 7 points for Bates tonight. Ten total blocks for Georgia. Bates has 3. And they still have Stady at 6. I thought she had picked up her 7th. And that should do it as Davenport yanks down likely the final rebound of the game. Georgia 74-54 winners over Auburn. The Lady Bulldogs now 15-4. They're 7-4, at least for the moment, in sole possession of 4th in the SEC, Coach.
Balanced scoring by UGA. They had some quality defense. They owned the glass. Just got to clean up the turnovers.
For Coach Christy Thomas-Cuddy and our entire SEC Network team, I'm Matt Stewart. Good night from Athens, where the Lady Bulldogs win by 20.